Hi, I'm Waylon Jennings, and I'd like to tell you a few things about my new album. It's called Closing In on the Fire. Somebody asked about the vibe in the studio. Everything came from so many different directions. Here I am, all the way from the 70s to the 90s. And then we had Greg Brown, very much into things that are going on now. So we all pulled each other in different directions till we got right in one vibe, you might say. The band, some of them were Memphis musicians, and the rest of the musicians were from different directions. We all got together and right off hit it off. And the thing I told them is just forget anything that you've ever heard me do, and you do what you feel, and if it don't work, we'll know it. Closing In on the Fire is a Tony Joe White song that I'd heard several years ago when he first wrote it. I always kept it in my briefcase to listen to it for my own pleasure, because I love that song. It's another one of those where he said, just everybody have fun on it. The song Just Watch Your Mama and Me was a song that I had been trying to write for a long time, but I just kind of put it away. I don't know, I guess I felt like it was something really personal. And it's for my children, and it's for Jessie too. And she even sings on that. Jessie and I have never done very many duets. We have such different styles. You know, you can be singing with Jessie and hitting a real high note, and she'll breathe on you. In other words, you'll be sitting there singing the high note, and all of a sudden you're by yourself. Trying to be funny there, but I love that song, and I'm glad I did it. Best Friends of Mine was a song. Years ago, I went to work at a radio station in Coolidge, Arizona, and Jim worked there, Jim Garshow. So we became pinball buddies. And after we left there, we moved into Phoenix, and he got me a job where he was working at. And that's where the old Chrysler was. It wouldn't turn right. So when we'd get there, we'd have to turn left, get to this house. It was about a half a block down to the right of the street, a one-way street. And we'd have to go past that and turn left and go up and turn left again and go up and turn left again and come around. But we drove that old Chrysler. I mean, like we said, we pushed it a lot farther than we drove. And that's what the first verse is about, is Jim. To this day, we're still very close friends. The second verse is, of course, about Hank Williams Jr. We played in Missoula, Montana, and Hank come and got me, took me out to his house. He lives out in the mountains there, and there it is in the valley. You look down there, and there's his colonial mansion with a flagpole with an old rebel flag on it, right in the middle of Montana. And somehow, you look at it and you say, what's wrong with this picture? You know? But that's Hank Jr., and we've never tried to change each other. The last part of the song is about Buddy Holly. He was the first guy who ever had enough faith in me to help me get started. And he and his wife in New York, and of course I was on the last tour with him. And before we left, we were playing a tape Buddy had produced on me. And Buddy told me then, he says, you know, he said, you're not really a hillbilly singer. Don't ever limit yourself. And I remember him saying that, and I remember his wife, who couldn't speak very much English then. She was listening to it, and she says, you know, Waylon, I don't know if that's hillbilly music or not, but she says, I like your singing. It gives me goosebumps. She talked almost as good as she cooked. I'd stand with Buddy before we went on the tour. Every night he'd say, just eat it and don't say anything. He taught me a lot in a short period of time that I never forgot, and there's never a week goes by that I don't think of him. In my living room, I have his motorcycle. When we were doing the album, Sting was coming to town to be on the CMA show, and we took some songs of his and started listening. We came up with She's Too Good For Me. But what I loved about the way he did it and everything is the groove. Once he starts, you might as well give up doing anything else. But he's a great songwriter. He came in, and I thought it was really neat. He came in, stuck out his hand, said, hi, I'm Sting. You know, we were listening to the song, And the more we listened, the more we realized that'd be a great man-woman duet. And we needed the woman. My part was the man part. So we got Sheryl Crow, and Sting rewrote the bridge, and she did a great job on it. She's a great little singer, good guitar player. She loves music, and I love her, and when I grow up, I want to be just like her. We got Mark Knopfler to play guitar on one of the songs. Kimmy Rhodes wrote the song. He's a girl from Texas. Now, Mark, when he hears a singer or he hears a song, that guitar becomes almost a duet. He plays with more feeling than anybody I've ever heard. I enjoy working with him. He's picky. We did a thing together, and I stayed with him. I thought, he thinks he can run me off. He thinks that he can wear me out, and we'll see. So I was there all day long. He said, I can't believe you stayed here all day long. You know, I said, well, it's my record, too. Anyway, he's a good friend. There's a song called Easy Money, and that came from so many different things in my life. I have a good friend by the name of Mr. Cartee, and he had a nickname for almost everybody. Well, he had a nickname for me. He'd say, what are you doing, Easy Money? And so he called me Easy Money, and I thought, well, that's a good song title. Well, where I come from, there's a creek called Blackwater Draw. Now, it used to go back of our house when my dad worked as a sharecropper. But I can remember them getting them old crawdads and pulling their heads off, you know, and putting them in that boiling water when I was a little kid. I don't remember ever eating one of them. But I guess that's a big thing. They call them mud bugs in some place, you know. Anyway, that's where they came from. I always wanted to use that name of that. You can step across Blackwater Draw most any place you want to because there's not that much water in West Texas. The song on the album called Back Home, that's purely about myself. I just sitting around thinking about it one day, and I just wanted to bring up most of the most of the trouble I've gotten into in my life. And I thought it was pretty clever, the part about I beat the DEA. Of course, I got busted one time. And the AMA, because I had an operation, that didn't get me. And the CMA, who keeps swatting at me every once in a while now. They may be ignoring me now, but that's okay. And that's what that song was about, that verse in particular. But it just kind of hit on a lot of things. And then there's one part in there, Jesse kind of frowned at me a little bit, about the prodigal son, that I thought he was awful clever. You can either be drunk or clever. And I know what the Baptist preachers thought. One time there was this preacher. Somebody put it on my desk, and I'll never know who. But it was during the time they were trying to bust me. But I kept seeing this tape. Finally, I got in the car, and I was driving somewhere, and I put it in. And right in the middle of it said, Luckenbach. That's his theme he's using for his Sunday sermon. And he's talking about, how often do we want to go back? Back home, you know. Sit on the porch, so to speak. And how often do we just want to do that? And he says, oh, not more than twice a day. Then he said, did you hear what the prophet Whalen said? He would like to go back to the basics. And he said, the prophets show up in strange places. That's what he said. And I could just see those deacons and elders taking him in, because it was all over the country about that bust, and wanting to talk to him about his prophets. You know, my life hadn't been without humor, and I was trying to be sexy the whole time. Now, all of that you can use what you want. That's a good ending, ain't it?